Sexual selection is a fascinating mechanism of evolution. In many species of animals, it has led to some very bizarre and spectacular forms of sexual dimorphism, or differences in characteristics between males and females. And many species of fishes are also under the evolutionary influences of sexual selection. Hey there, I'm Koa, and at this channel we're always learning about and engaging with animals in the outdoors so that we can spread knowledge and be nature heroic for ourselves and our little ones. And I've done my best to put this video together in a fun, casual way for the non-scientist, avoiding too much technical terminology when I could, but it should still offer a good understanding of the basic processes and theories of sexual selection. And this is a topic in biology that will discuss sexual organs and reproduction, not just in fishes, but in humans as well, so you are forewarned. Also, take a moment to subscribe. It's absolutely free and easy to do. Just click a button. All right, let's get into this. Sexual selection is a mechanism of evolution, and is conceptually the same as natural selection. But those two mechanisms still remain distinct, so I'm quickly going to define and then animate a simple example of natural selection, and then do the same with an example of sexual selection to make the rest of this video more understandable. Natural selection is the mechanism of evolution, where organisms within a population with certain traits are more or less likely to survive and reproduce in a particular environment than organisms of that population with differing traits. Example, say we have an isolated population of a certain species of fish in a lake. This species specializes on eating nuts that fall into the water from a small species of tree that grows along the shore. One day, a fire burns down all the small trees, leaving only a bigger and different type of tree that could survive the fire. This bigger tree produces bigger nuts. There are a few fish in this population with mouths big enough to eat the big nuts, and the fish with the big mouth trait are able to eat and survive, while the fish with the smaller mouths starve and are unable to survive. The genes that coded for the trait of a big mouth in the survivors is likely to be passed along to future generations. The big mouth trait has been naturally selected to be passed on because it is better suited for the environment than the small mouth trait. And I did add another example of natural selection within that example, and I bet you can find it. But now let's move to sexual selection. So sexual selection is a process where individuals within a population with certain traits are more or less likely to obtain mates and have reproductive success compared to other individuals within that population with differing traits. Example, within that same population of fish in our first example, let's say that the males have a bright spot on the side of their body. This spot does not help them find food or swim faster or aid in their survival in any way. It actually increases the chance of a predator seeing them. But females prefer males with the brightest spot. So a male with the brightest spot in this population, able to survive to sexual maturity, is going to have greater success mating with the females. The bright spot will be passed onto his and her offspring. So his bright spot is a sexually selected trait. So basically, natural selection determines what traits are best suited for survivability in an environment to reach an age and opportunity to mate and have offspring, while sexual selection determines what traits are best suited for reproductive success when those mating opportunities arise. Sexual selection is often divided into two subcategories, intersexual selection and intersexual selection, where inter means between and intra means within. So we have between sexes and within sexes. We could also refer to sexual selection as the processes of intraspecific competition, where again intra means within and specific means a species. It's all a big competition within a species population to pass on genetic code. Intersexual selection is how the mating preferences of one sex affect the traits of the other sex, like a female choosing a male or vice versa. And intrasexual selection is the effects of competition within a sex to obtain mates, like male-to-male combat or resource defense. Many different forms of sexually selected traits can play a role in attracting the other sex, or helping to intimidate or even battle the same sex, or enable other means to achieve reproductive success. This fish, the plainfin midshipman, woos females by humming as they contract muscles around the gas bladder. This bull chub has keratinized bumps on its swollen head that aids in reproductive success. In many elasmobranchs, or sharks, the males have teeth that are longer and sharper, which are used to grab females during mating, or what is theorized in the six-gilled shark, to nip at the female's gill slits.
Yeah, that's a kind of...
In evolutionary response, females have thicker skin to protect against the rough mating rituals. Photophore arrangements, or light-producing organs, on lantern fishes attract mates in the dark depths. These sexual selected traits can be chemical, they can be behavioral, they can be morphological, and so much more. There are many other sexual dimorphisms that act as sexually selected traits, which are also known as secondary sexual characteristics, that are usually capable of being developed during sexual maturity. And in fishes, these traits often are only exhibited or more pronounced during mating and spawning rituals. Like in many salmonids, many males develop a kype, or the hook snout, a hump, and brighter colorations before and during spawning. Primary sexual characteristics are organs such as ovipositors and genitalia and other organs used for parental care. And sometimes a sexually selected trait can be both a primary and secondary sexual characteristic, but we'll explore that more later. Let's take a closer look at an example of intersexual selection. So intersexual selection primarily involves mate choice, where one sex is choosing the other sex based on a trait, or what is more likely a number of traits. In fishes and most other species of animals, the females are most often doing much of the choosing because they are of the sex investing more in the production of gametes, or eggs, and overall rearing of offspring. There are many exceptions, but I'll get to those later. Like in anemone fishes, aka the clownfishes, where males mostly guard and fan the eggs until hatching. But it is important to remember that a male will still choose a female to attract, even if he is just trying to attract any female he can. I definitely known a few guys like that in my life. But it is still the female's choice to choose the most desirable male to receive genetic code from to fertilize her eggs, because her eggs are a limited resource, and she needs to find the best male with the best genetic code that she can. So let's take a male of the green swordtail species. This elongated lower caudal fin extension, commonly called a sword, exists as an elaborate ornament to attract females during courtship displays. Males with longer swords are more appealing to females, and males with longer swords are more likely to attract a female for mating. The long tail is a trait being selected upon by sexual selection. This is female choice, and female choice is a mechanism of sexual selection. And it's important to remember that sexual selection is a multivariate process. And what I mean by that is that there's usually not just one trait involved in reproductive success. It's normally many traits. So within swordtails, besides the sword, there are other traits at work, like the male's colorations and even a courtship display. This courtship display would be considered a behavioral trait or a behavioral signal and is also being analyzed for choice by the female. And a key point to remember with mate choice is that as one sex evolves a trait, such as a swordtail's long tail, the other sex must evolve a preference for the trait. The desire for and the trait itself evolve in tandem, or in some cases, there's actually a pre-existing preference for a trait. Where, of course, the desire for in the female swordtail is also a trait of the genotype, or genes, that's manifesting as a behavior of the phenotype. And the phenotype is just how genes are expressed. So as the desire for the trait increases, the trait itself becomes more pronounced and becomes involved in a positive feedback loop in a process known as runaway sexual selection, or a Fisherian runaway. So that sword, that elongated growth of the caudal fin, this does not help the male survive. It is metabolically costly to produce and to carry around. And also, that easily seen and cumbersome tail makes the male more susceptible to predation, such as by other piscivorous fishes. And within many species of the swordtail's family, i.e. the other closely related species, the same burdens come with the various bright colorations, markings, and fancy ornamentations. And this is seen in other species from other families as well. And many sexually selected traits are further exaggerated by artificial selection, where humans have much control over breeding and predation, such as in these popular aquarium fishes. So these sexually selected traits that confer disadvantages for survival are called honest advertisements. The males are advertising to the females that they are able to survive while enduring these burdens, or handicaps. They're honestly showing their metabolic and physical capabilities to survive in that environment. And so this falls under the handicap principle. But natural selection does have a way of limiting or breaking these sexually selected traits. Yes, males with larger swords attract more females, but males with too large of a sword would be unable to even swim to find food. They wouldn't be able to survive, let alone mate. So even though that positive feedback loop exists, natural selection will curb the elongation of tails within a population. Thus, natural selection will curb sexual selection. So for another example, let's take these two live-bearing Poecilid species. A male of these species has a modified anal fin that acts as an insemination device called a gonopodium. When performing courtship rituals, a male will extend his gonopodium almost perpendicular to his body as a display signal for the female. And females prefer males with larger gonopodia, which also means that the females prefer males with larger genitalia. But in environments with more predators, the males have smaller gonopodia, even though the female's preference remains for the larger gonopodia. This is most likely because a larger gonopodium makes for escaping predators more difficult by adding drag and reducing escape speed, so natural selection is limiting the genetic variance or size of this trait. In these fishes, genitalia that is too big is dangerous and costly to carry around. So indeed, the size of genitalia does matter in some instances. And I bet you're wondering if this translates into human sexual selection. Does the size of the male penis play an important role in reproductive success? Well, we can briefly explore this tangent. First, we must wonder as to why the human male has a much longer and thicker penis, both relatively and absolutely, compared to any of the other primates. And there are ideas out there, but there is still much research and substantial evidence needed to create strong theories. So some of the ideas are that the human male penis is an ornament that attracts females, or even intimidates other males. The shape and size of a penis may influence sperm competition by removing a previous male's sperm from the female during intercourse. A larger penis offers a woman more satisfaction during sex and is more likely to aid a female to orgasm, which could allow for better sperm retention and sperm activation, as well as future opportunities for the male to mate with that female. And there's more. It's an intriguing area that is still in need of a lot of research to supply evidence and create stronger theories. Human sexual selection is very complicated, and I have no idea how they measured the erect penises of gorillas, but I'm sure that was a very interesting job. Yeah. Body size can play a role in sexual selection. Within many families of fishes, we see male-to-male intrasexual dominance based on size. This is especially apparent in nest-guarding species, where larger males are able to build and protect better nests in better areas from other males, and females will choose larger males because these larger males are more likely to be better protectors from egg-eating predators or even other males from within the species trying to destroy the eggs. There's actually a lot of strange and complex sexual selection going on here. Check out my other short video in the description to learn more. And you'll notice that overall size is not only a trait acted upon by intersexual selection with the male-to-male competition, but intersexual selection with the female choosing larger males. And also, a larger male is better able to survive against predation. So natural selection is also favoring this large trait. So we must remember that sexual selection is very complicated. I haven't even touched on really what sperm competition is, post-copulatory success, epigenetic factors. It can get very, very complicated. So this video covered the basics. But I do want to touch on an interesting role reversal in pipefishes and seahorses real quick. So males are the sex that end up carrying the eggs around either in a ventral pouch or along the tail, depending on the species. The males do the choosing of females based on their size, coloration, and courtship displays. This role reversal is much different from the most other instances of mate choice where female choice predominates. So male synathids end up investing time and energy in rearing the offspring. The male's ability to carry the eggs is the limiting resource that the females are competing to attain. And that's just absolutely fascinating to think about. Males that appear pregnant, but they're carrying the young until they hatch, and they actually have some parenting that they do. So again, please subscribe if you're not yet subscribed. Again, sexual selection is a very complicated topic that I could have spent 2 hours making a video and not even touched everything. I hope this helped you a bit or intrigued you to go research more. There's so much out there. And to my patrons, thank you so much for helping to cover my software costs. You guys are keeping me afloat. Love it. I have a lot of projects lined up, but with this one, I got way too involved. It was just too intriguing. And just stay tuned. Yeah. Cheers. Spread some knowledge and be nature heroic. I'll show you what the back of my mug says in a future episode. It's hilarious.